Also good afternoon from me. I've got the honor to do the last talk of today, and it's never known if that is a good thing or a bad thing, but as I can see, most of you are still there, so I hope it's a good thing. Application of the technology of nanoparticles at Roche, that's my talk for today. And well, first I'm going to give a few slides for the introduction of RNA. We've heard quite a bit about that today. However, this is a slightly different kind of introduction. Some of you may have already seen this image, which basically reflects the life cycle of new or emerging technologies. So at the beginning, usually of every technology, there's a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of expectations, but there's only very little knowledge known in the field. So and at some point of time, the reality kicks in, more or less. It's not as easy as people had thought at the beginning. So the expectations, they fall quite considerably. And if the technology survives and recovers, it does that in a, in a longer period of time. However, at the end, that would normally lead to the technology being applied in a more sensible and realistic manner. And also you build on the knowledge that you gain throughout the experiments. So this can also be very nicely applied to RNA therapeutics, I think. So following the same kind of curve, I put together some points. Okay, focusing on Roche. So, I mean, there's been lots of other things also going on. Around about the year 2000, there was a lot of activity, and here as well, expectations and hype, and a lot of companies were founded. And Roche joined the field in 2007 when it heavily invested in the area of SI RNA therapeutics. However, we soon realized that, again, the expectations were not met. Delivery failures of compounds appeared. So 3 years later, Roche opted out of that technology, so after 3 years. And other companies were also struggling at that time. However, the field, I think we all agree, is on its way up again. It's slowly but steadily getting more interesting to people again. Resulted also in the fact that Roche acquired a company, a Danish company called Xantaris, which are experts in the delivery and manufacturing of antisense oligonucleotides. So we entered that field again. And I think the success story will hopefully go on, because nowadays we actually see the fruit of the research people have done. So several compounds are in late stage clinical studies and have also already entered the market. So I hope we're on a good way there. So it's no surprise that the field of RNA therapeutics has grown quite a bit in terms of companies being involved. And it has also diversified a little bit in that we see antisense technology. So we've got short singular stranded oligonucleotides, the usual siRNA, and also we've already heard this morning from the colleague from BioNTech, also the mRNA technology. So we're diversifying a bit further, and you can see in the top right-hand corner, there's a very small image of compounds that are currently preclinical or in clinical studies. So there is a pipeline which looks quite healthy, I hope. So as Roche did most of its work between 2007 and 2010, I have to maybe say at the beginning that what I'm going to show you in the next 10 minutes or so is actually data from that time. So it's already a little bit older, and there wasn't any nano assembler available at the time. So maybe they could have done more if they had the system at the time. But anyway, some of the results are still quite interesting, I think. So I'd like to share them with you of what Roche has done in terms of delivery. And if we talk about siRNA, then obviously we need to talk about some delivery system. We heard that already a few times today, so they don't go, or they need some system which transports them to their target cell, and also they need help in being taken up into the cells, actually. So one of the technologies we looked at Roche was this SNLP technology called stable nucleic acid lipid particles. And also in these slides are a few words on lipoplexes, on liposomes. So I'm not sure if you're aware of this term, SNLP. So it was named in 2006, but more recently you see the abbreviation LNP. We've already seen that also today. So I'm going to use this maybe interchangeably. At the time it was still known as a SNLP system. So what do the particles look like, or what is their characteristic? So we've got low surface charge, we've got small uniformly sized particles. And we've also already heard today a few times that they're highly efficient in hepatic delivery. So that is all we've already, or is known, we've already covered. They're multi-component lipid formulations containing several different kinds of lipids. So we've got cationic lipids, we've got the fusogenic lipids, PEG lipids, and then also cholesterol that make up this particle. And on the forefront of this technology is Alnylam, and they're still quite heavily involved with that technology. And what they did for their lipidic, or for their platform, is that they took the cationic lipid and they, as one of the important lipids in the system, and they discovered if they modified that cationic lipid, they can then also modify the properties and the efficacy of the resulting particles. So in this image on the right, you see at the top right-hand corner a few lipidic structures of lipids that they synthesized, and in the graphic down below, that's a study they conducted in rats using the same LNP or SNLP formulation, but they differed in their cationic lipid. And what I think is quite interesting in this graph is that depending on the lipids, or on the cationic lipids that they're used, they see quite a broad range of the potency, or of their efficacious dose, actually covering two orders of magnitude. So depending on the lipid, or depending on the lipid, we see quite a difference in efficacy of the particle. So when Roche got involved in this field, they were working together with Techmira, who were also involved in that technology, and Techmira sent two samples of different SNLPs, so SNLP-C or SNLP-B and SNLP-C. And in-house, we obviously also wanted to take a look at what is the difference, how do they behave. So we went on a head-to-head comparison of both of these compounds, and in the graph that you see on the left-hand side at the top, the violet bars represent the formulation in SNLP-C. You see a very nice dose-dependent dependency compared to the saline solution, and what you also see is that it's quite a good efficacy in that system. If we look at the right-hand side, the dark blue bars, this is the SNLP-B formulation, also shows efficacy in the system, which is good. However, if you compare dose to dose of both formulations, we see that the SNLP-C formulation is 5 times more efficacious. And this was actually the formulation at the time that Alnylam was promoting. There's no data here for the tox, but between those two formulations, there was no difference noted. And if you look at the bottom left-hand corner, this is quite a nice representation of the siRNA in the liver. So we see that for the same dose, the SNLP-C formulation, the violet one, is able to deliver more siRNA to the liver. So again, design of these lipids is influencing the efficacy of the siRNA delivery, which was already interesting. So Roche then also decided to invest a little bit more time and efforts in screening for other cationic lipids that they wanted to use. And in this case, they were looking at liposomal formulations. Alnylam, again, at the time had been using this lipid quite often in their formulation. And we then went and synthesized and screened about, I think, 29 cationic lipids. And obviously checked how their ability to form stable liposomes or lipoplexes was. And if they were okay, we would then also test them in vivo in a mouse model. So below you see the target profile, so what we actually wanted to achieve, 70% binding affinity, specific size, and then zeta potential. On the right-hand side, we see the different parameters that can be adjusted to prepare liposomal formulations, which I'm not going to go into at this stage. So I'm just going to give you the results from these activities. Again, I presume no nanoassembler, so I'm not quite sure how long this study took. But if you see that they generated 350 samples, you can probably imagine what work effort that was. Out of these samples, 250 had quite good properties in terms of making stable liposomes. And again, out of these 215 samples, they were scaled up a little bit more, and 60 of them were tested in vivo in a rat or in a mouse model. And during all this testing, one of the most prominent cationic lipids that that they discovered was the one you see below that box. And below, what we also show in this case is like six different formulations that were prepared from this lipid. It's the same lipid, just different kinds of co-components or even different kind of ratios. Out of these six formulations, three are formulated with ApoB siRNA and three with factor 7 mRNA. On the right-hand side, then, you see the results from this in vivo study in mouse. So we're only looking at the factor 7 mRNA in this case, and you see we're looking at A, C, and E. What we notice, first of all, is that there's no or not any readout for formulation 107C, which actually is a nanoparticle, so it's not liposomal, and the size was actually quite large, so that's probably why that didn't lead to any meaningful results. We see activity, and we also see difference in the efficacy between the two formulations. So conclusion of that was the design of the cationic lipids and, of course, the formulation development greatly influences the efficacy of the siRNA. In a third step, or as a third experiment, they thought, okay, so hepatic delivery, that seems at least on paper to be straightforward, and this ties in very nicely with what we heard in this morning from the colleague from the Medicinal University Hospital in Hannover. So obviously something which is difficult to transfect, difficult to treat. In this case, they also looked at leukemia cells, obviously a large medical need. And the status at that time was that they couldn't really be transfected using the regular particles and cationic lipids that were there at the time. So the path to optimization, I called this again, this was a stepwise approach, trying to find the best way forward. So they started with several tests, and what they found was quite interesting is that if they optimized their cationic lipid, they found that if there was small percentage between 5 and 10% of alkylated DMA present, that increased the efficacy already quite considerably. You see that in the dark red bars in the middle of that graph. And the interesting thing actually in this is that the alkylated DMA is an impurity that you come across if you're making your lipids. So it was actually dirty batches of lipids, if you so want to say, but that's what they discovered. So that was already one of the interesting facts in this case. And they tested these concepts in these MOLM-13 leukemia cell line, which they were using at the time. In the next step, they were thinking of how can we further rationalize the development of our particles, and then they were looking at adding biocompatible polymers, in this case cationic ones such as protamine sulfate, or also anionic ones like hyaluronic acid, which would hopefully increase the transfection rate. Basically, these were added in terms of, stabilizing the particle and then helping in formation. The next step was then to include membrane-disrupting peptides. Then, as with every other cell, blood cells also, you know, have a membrane that is a bit more tricky to target than normal solid tumor or solid organs. And again, in the cell line, we see the efficacy of these variations to the formulations. So the pink ones represent formulations where the biocompatible polymers were added, so we see efficacy here yet again. And then the two last ones in orange and in green, this is a combination of the peptides together with biocompatible, with the polymers. So we see that stepwise approach in that stage gave quite good results in the cell line. So the outcome of this study was that the LNP-based delivery systems were quite promising as a potential in vitro tool, so they seemed to be transfecting these cells quite nicely. And if you so want to say, it could have been a starting point maybe for the in vivo prototype formulations. But again, at that time, Roche opted out, so this wasn't followed up. Coming back to the beginning, to these SNALP particles, which are also in the literature I've seen are known as Abuto's LNP delivery platform. So Abuto's at the moment is the company that makes these particles. And this is actually out of the delivery systems for oligonucleotides or RNA therapeutics, one of the most mature technologies. On the left-hand side, you see several clinical and preclinical studies which use this technology, which cover siRNA and other antisense molecules. And you may say, okay, that the technology is already 10 years old, so it was patented or started to be patented in 2006. However, Arbutus is still quite busy in patenting formulations, so it's not just a general thing that Roche was doing at the time or you guys may be doing. There's still a lot of potential in actually changing formulation components and then further increasing the efficacy or potency of their formulations. The second technology I just briefly want to mention is something which is called DPC, so dynamic polyconjugates. This was previously invented by a company called Myrus, which Roche acquired in 2008, I think it was, and then further developed that technology till they then also had to sell it. But they were quite active in that field. So what's the dynamic polyconjugate technology? Again, it's a multi-component system, and we see the components of that on the left-hand side. So we've got the siRNA, which is our target or our cargo, which we want to deliver. Then we've got an endo-osmolytic polymer as a backbone, and then different ligands conjugated to this polymer, for instance, a PEG, which is usually used, and then targeting ligands depending on what the tissue is you want to target. And on the left-hand side, I mean, this is the principle that we all imagine how these things work. So the conjugate gets taken up into the endosome and then through pH change, environmentally changed, the membrane disrupts and then releases our cargo. So the name comes from dynamic, meaning environmentally responsive to the chemical bond. So pH change here cuts the bonds. And polyconjugate, obviously, because we've got things conjugated covalently to these to the structures. So obviously, Roche was also busy in doing experiments with these systems. And in this case, we were looking at two different formulations of DPC, where one used the hepatocyte-specific ligand GalNAc, and the other formulation was conjugated to glucose, which is a non-targeting ligand. And what you can see in this graph is that indeed the GalNAc, the hepatocyte-targeting formulation, showed a higher efficacy and target mRNA knockdown compared to the non-targeting system. Again, if you look on the right-hand side, in red we have the siRNA, and we see that for the N or for the GalNAc system, we see quite a lot of siRNA in the hepatocytes. So overall, increased efficacy and targeting by conjugating to the right targeting ligand. And in this case, Roche used the GalNAc for the hepatic delivery. And there's also success, as mentioned, with this technology. It's also in the clinics at various stages of development. And at the moment, what we saw in 2016, so just recently, is this compound, which is manufactured by Arrowhead. And you see here the polymeric backbone and then the SI cargo, which is not covalently attached. You will see that in this case, as this is the second generation, I've been told, of the DPC. So there's no covalent bond between cargo and polymer. So this was quite exciting until beginning of November. So around the 10th of November, news came out that FDA placed a hold on the phase two clinical trial, which is never a good thing to happen to any company. And it wasn't based on the actual results in the clinical study, but on preclinical toxicology studies in non-human primates. So there were several deaths in the toxicology study, which they couldn't explain at the time. So for safety reasons, this study was halted. Investigations are ongoing, so it'll be quite interesting to see what the outcome is of this and if that has any kind of effect on further programs, because this isn't the only one or the only DPC in clinics. There are still several other ones. But at the moment, we think it's not really down to this delivery system. So in summary, as I mentioned, this is work which has been done 5 or 6, 7 years ago. What we did at Roche, so during the years that we actually actively worked on the siRNA, we looked at and evaluated different delivery technologies. So we looked at the SNALP technology, also liposomes. So this was only like a very short overview of what we've done. And then the DPC technology in general, I think this is, you guys also see that when you work with these systems, is that in vitro we see quite good results. In some animal studies, we saw already some quite promising data, but as everything was halted in 2010, then nothing of this was further followed up. So, so that's the data as it stands at the moment. And with this, I'm also at the end already of my talk. So, thank you very much for listening, and yeah, I take some questions. Please.
Thank you, Kirsten, for this nice presentation full of peaks and slopes, and we all hope Roche will stay in the reality plateau, which will definitely contain a growing number of nanomedicines. So, questions for Kirsten? Gesine. Okay, we spotted you.
Since now we're on the way up again in your diagram of innovative medicines, yes. According to you, what are the main aspects that made, I mean, Roche or other companies take up this RNA field again? What are the main major achievements that have happened between that big dip and now?
Yes, coming back out. I think, and I'm, this is just my, from the top of my head. I think in the olden days, a lot of knowledge has been generated, but it wasn't probably used appropriately. You know, there was this high expectations, and then they did find something, but it wasn't what they'd expected. So that's why the fall was so deep. And there's still lots of unmet medical needs, as we call it, so diseases out there which gene therapy might be a solution to. So I think a lot of companies have started to reinvest, but with a more realistic approach towards these systems. It's not the magic bullet you will have within, 2 months or something. For the siRNA. But we also saw there's different technologies now available. So Roche has now invested in antisense oligonucleotides. So these are single-stranded nucleotides that don't have the issues of siRNA. They're more stable. They seem to be more easily taken up into cells. So that is what Roche thinks would be the way forward. And then we've seen the mRNA technology. So I think there's a lot of more knowledge now out there, and then also in making these particles and knowing about their properties. And I think, as with everything, again, it's the medical need, so that we can really not target some diseases. So that would be quite good to have.
I think I just wanted to add something. Sorry, I don't mean to enter in your... you can also explain it that the very general medicine targets like kinase inhibitors and GPCR inhibitors or activator has all has been done, and really now there is a need for innovative targets and innovative ways to do medicines.
You mentioned application of hyaluronic acid as a ligand for leukemia cell in blood. Do you have some experience with such particles?
With
particles decorated by hyaluronic acid?
No. I personally don't. As I said, I think this data was already from 2008. So I apologize. I don't know. Don't have any experience.
Because it's not it's not easy target. Because CD44 is not the one ligand or
exactly.
receptor. It's hundreds of different spliced proteins. So some are not able to incorporate particles inside the cell.
Exactly. I mean, as mentioned, this is just a very high-level overview. I mean, there's lots of more data available, and I'm sure the colleagues have done quite thorough research. And again, it was stopped, so it was never actually followed up. But oh no, I completely agree with you. Yeah.
No, please not. Don't shout.
You mentioned that there is a more realistic approach and that people more focus on the unmet medical needs. You could also argue, from an island perspective at least, that they've been able to master one organ for delivery and let their clinical program be dictated by the organ that they can deliver to. Is that also a way of looking at the developments in the field?
I mean, the hepatic delivery is I think, high on everyone's agenda. If you look at the clinical studies that I briefly had on one slide, and most of them are hepatic targets, which seems to be the most or the easiest, the low-hanging fruit for the time. But I know from some other companies, because there's only so, I mean, the hepatic space is only, well, it's limited, so at some point of time you will have to move to something else. And if you look at what's coming to the early stage of the clinics, it has already broadened quite a bit, so moving away from the liver. So we've got CNS targets, rare diseases. I mean, we're not limited to injecting compounds subcutaneously. We can also, or we've seen intrathecal, so into the spine applications. So the targets are getting a bit broader, but it's not as easy as for hepatic. Yeah.
So this is a more like a general view question. So it's interesting the historical perspective you presented. It seems that the delivery and targeting mechanisms are still a challenge. So what is the next thing we are all waiting for?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think one of the, at least we see also with some of our compounds is obviously, I mean, if you get it to the cell, that's stage one. And then if you then get it into the cell, that's already stage two you need to master. And then what is currently, I think, in all of the systems still quite an issue is getting it out of the endosome again. So because usually it, well, at least the molecules I've seen, they don't readily come out of the endosome. So, because this could then reduce the dose you have to give and you know, make it more beneficial for the patient. So I presume that is one of the things which is high on everyone's agenda, because that's that doesn't depend on any target. So it's just the principle. So I suppose if anyone manages to fix that, they're probably up there very high. Yeah.
Well, I think no more questions. Thank you,
Excellent.
Kirsten.
Well, thank you
so much for...
Thank you.